Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Computer Wednesday. In today's episode, we're gonna continue our episode that I made 2 months ago that you can check out here. Apple moving to basically USB-C. So now we have our first confirmation that Apple is finally gonna use USB-C on an iOS device. So what is USB-C? Basic summary is it's a universal standard. Before USB used to exist, there were multiple systems. Basically, there were one connector specifically designed for keyboard, one connector for mouse, another keyboard connector for printers, another for serial interface. So USB comes along and it's like, okay, all of that through one connection. So that was USB 1.0. Now the whole idea of this standard was that when they're gonna upgrade the standard, they will still make sure that it is backwards compatible. This is very critical. That simply means, let's say you, most of us are very familiar with USB 3.0 and USB 2.0. So that means if you have USB 3.0 pen drive, it will work with USB 2.0 port and vice versa. So this really allowed the computer industry to become much more standardized. Your equipments will work with much larger equipment selection. And this really helped to reduce e-waste. And this was turbocharged by EU's movement to reduce e-waste, basically multiple charges. And Mobile Congress basically requested that every manufacturer, including Apple, switch to one standardized system. Now, every manufacturer, as in from Sony Ericsson that time, and to Nokia, to Motorola, to Lenovo, to Asus, to whoever was making mobile phones, to basically Samsung also, to jump and simply say, okay, we're gonna standardize on one standard. Now, which is the standard they chose? They chose USB. So that allowed, huge amount of saving in terms of basically fancy chargers. Instead of making fancy chargers, everybody started to make one standardized charger, and it will work against, like, let's say you can have a charger that works with your Samsung. It will also work against, like, you know, let's say Motorola. So in those sort of scenario, the e-waste went down considerably. So that was awesome. However, even though Apple said they're gonna do it, they didn't do it. So EU was like, bro, we have to, file some action. So Apple was like, no, we are working on it. And that's why this iOS move is so big. Now, if you are not familiar with the idea of that, why the heck iOS and macOS is so different, is think of it this way. The instruction set that is in the processors of these two puppies are completely different. They are similar amongst generation, no matter how far back you go. Like you buy the first basically MacBook, it will still have still instruction set similar to the latest MacBook. Only latest one will have extra instructions. Same goes for iPhone. So even the oldest iPhone you can buy will have instruction set that is similar to the instruction set that is present in your newest one. Only difference is newer one will have a bit more. So that way, if you write a application or software that will work with one instruction set, it will work across generations. So you don't have to like, okay, I wrote an Instagram application. Now that application cannot work. Let's say it worked in iPhone 4, it will not work in iPhone 5. It will work flawlessly. That is the whole point. That's why we have two instruction set. So the PC instruction set is kind of very ancient. So nobody really wants to change it. And at this point, changing it will cost trillions of dollars. And there has been some attempts. I will link the video down below there that a new instruction set is trying to be created, simply because the instruction set that we have on the PC side, both including Mac and Linux and Windows, it's kind of bloated at this point. It's been built in a hurry, and it did not have enough foresight because it was the first of its kind. So this new system, they are trying, like, they have a bit more foresight. They know how things work, how things fail. So they maybe in the future there may be in completely different architecture, but right now there is only two architecture number one for your PC, architecture number two, which is for your mobile systems. So for this reason, Mac switched to USB-C much earlier because it has much bigger bandwidth and much common basically instruction set, which includes USB. So from their point to change to basically USB-C standard was basically changing a physical port. So they jumped it quickly. Now this year, iPad Pro has USB-C. That means somebody sat down in Apple and like figured out how to write instruction set so proper USB system works with iOS. Now it's not impossible, but it is kind of tricky. So now we're gonna have more freedom. So this whole switch started with with one core aspect that Apple is now in danger at this point. Now, this happened because of losing market share. Now you might be like, okay, Apple just became $1 trillion company. That's absolutely true. However, if you see basically how many phones are sold, as in smartphones, basically per Android, Apple is barely selling 0.01 iPhone. So basically for one iPhone, there is upwards of 100 Android sold. So at beginning, you don't have to worry about it. But over time, Apple will end up shrinking so much that the whole advantage they used to experience is like, you know, my app store, if you make an application in my app store, everybody like, you know, will buy it because most of the people have it. That advantage is slowly shifting to Google, and Google is like slowly upgrading their system so thoroughly. At this point, they are so ahead of Apple that in 2018 Google I/O conference, they announced they had an AI that already worked, like they already had spent 3 to 4 years behind scene working on it, that can make phone calls. And at the same year, Apple comes out and like, you know, our new phone, and it has better emojis. Like that was the biggest meme I saw around 9 gag. It's like, you know, oh, Google I/O, we have a, you know, a artificial intelligence that can make phone calls for you and, you know, set up a, basically act as a pseudo secretary. And Apple is like, we have emojis. So you can understand, like, all the problems that Google had, all the issues Android had, over time they are getting fixed. Like for instance, everybody says like, you know, Android has terrible battery life, but my experience with Android, like this phone, Lenovo YP1, it's I had very great experience with this. Why? It has 5000 milliamp hour battery. Now you might be like, okay, that's unfair competition, because Apple barely, at the time of its launch, Apple barely had a battery that was like 3000 milliamp hour. Now that's 3 amp versus 5 amp. Now you might be like, okay, that means this is very inefficient. I used to think that Apple actually has good battery life, until I realized this puppy has basically dual SIM. What does that mean? That simply means it has to maintain and always listen to two independent networks. So it's always listening to two networks that flat out doubles your power consumption. This also has dual SIM and SD card system. Basically, now it also has to register a memory. At that time, you could only buy to 64 GB. And this one, I had 32 GB. I put a 64 GB SD card extra on top of that, so I had much more data on it, and I can do much more things with it. Basically, it also had NFC, and it costed 1/8 of the cost of iPhone. And the only thing that I could truly, like, actually say that, you know, Apple does better was, at that time, was the camera. So from my point of view, all I was like spending 80 grand, like in Indian rupees, 80 to 90 grand was just so I can get a camera. And at that time, this whole computational photography where you can, you know, have shallow background wasn't a big thing. So I was okay with this. And more I digged into it, the more I realized that if you are spending that kind of money, if you are locking down your ecosystem, if you are locking down your hardware, you should get good battery life. From that lens, the Apple's battery life is like, really? That's all you're getting? Like, I was able to get 2 days of use, like, and I'm talking like full use on this. Like, I'm watching 6-7 hours of video on screen on time, and it had higher resolution also. It had full HD. At that time, Apple did not have full HD. So all this idea, like, you know, oh, Apple has good battery life, compared to what? Like, okay, Apple has good battery life, but compared to what? Like, this has twice the phone. Now you might be like, okay, Apple is smooth. It better be. Like, I'm spending that kind of money, it better be freaking smooth. Now this is where Apple's problem began. Android at the beginning was horrid, undeniably so. It was unimaginably slow. But over time, Google kept fixing it. At this point, this phone can open an application that is like, you know, 1/10 of a second. Apple can open an application in 1/30 of a second. So that's much faster. Here's the deal, that perception is much lower now. Now you will feel like, you know, if you're using Apple, you will feel, okay, it's a bit faster, but you won't feel, holy crap, that day and night difference is shrinking. At this point, if you buy like the current flagship of Android series, Samsung Note 9, which is very expensive, like the 512 GB model is very expensive. And yes, it has 512 GB inbuilt. So, and you can also add 512 GB SD card. So it is very expensive. It has almost the same app launch time, same smoothness, and it's cheaper. So that whole advantage, like, you know, it's smoother, has bigger battery life, it's no longer as black and white as it used to be. So Apple lost there, and that, you know, the market share is shrinking. The innovation is no longer there. Like Apple Siri, when it came out, everybody was like, whoa, DARPA technology. As in, like, anybody who actually works in military will tell you, the military only always chooses a technology that works reliably over a new technology. Google was practicing new technology. Consequence, their technology was not as polished, as reliable as Siri. But see how far they have come. Now they have a technology that can freaking make phone calls for you. So at this point, Apple is reaching a point where they're bottlenecked. Their competition is becoming much better, and the market pie that they used to, take is now shrinking. Now they thought they're gonna go to India and China and, you know, become the dominant. Now the insult Apple did to Indian market specifically was kind of very awful. Like, as an Indian, like, I understand you might be like, okay, Indians don't buy a lot of iPhone, so let's release 2 year old iPhone in the market. I'm like, what? Like, what? Like, who thought this is a good idea to, like, flat out insult Indian Apple buyers? Like, oh yeah, in India we're gonna launch 2 years old model. What the heck? Who came up with that? And in China, when they're like, okay, China has more money, they forgot China makes the damn thing. So Apple is kind of very known for screwing over their customers, especially when you are going about repair. I will link that description video down below also. So a lot of people started to scam Apple itself. So Apple always allot a specific amount of money for repairs and, like, you know, things of that nature. Even though they are overcharging, they still have to spend some money. So they were like allotting $500 million to $1 billion. Like, China market will consume that much for repair. Like, this is their budget. It ended up costing them $3 to $8 billion. Like, $3 billion was just flat out lost simply because everybody started scamming Apple. So it was kind of a nice change of pace. So flat out they insulted Indian market, then China's market they did not take it seriously, and voila. So at this point, their market share is no longer as dominant as they used to be. US market is already saturated. Indian market, like, flat out their insult, and top of the fact that Android at this point is so good that saying that blanket statement, like, oh, iPhone just works, it no longer sells as many phone as you would think. And on top of that, be mindful, India jumped from feature phone to current generation of Android without any transition period. So we don't have the experience of, oh, very ugly Androids. We just, like, okay, feature phone, boom, smartphone. Like, we directly jumped into 3G and directly jumped into 4G. So in these sort of context, iPhone no longer holds up. And Indians, as I told you, we were used to feature phones. We can handle much more technical aspect of the equipment. So if somebody says to me, oh, iPhone just works, like, I can just pair up my Bluetooth headphones, I can do manual pairing because I'm used to feature phones where I actually transferred song from one Sony Ericsson to another Sony Ericsson using infrared. Yes, that used to be a technology. So I'm far more comfortable. But that insult and top of that, like, the lack of feature set, and I already told you the fact that they are like, okay, my phone has battery life. Against what? Like, against this? Like, it has full HD screen. So you really have to realize, like, the black and white advantage they used to have is no longer there. So what is Apple's response to this crisis? Well, now they have more product in their lineup. Before basically Steve Jobs passing, everybody was familiar with the idea there is one iPhone. Every year there will be one iPhone. Now after that, now we have used to have two, and this year they changed the formula again. Now they have three iPhones. Now this is good and bad. Good, more iPhones will be sold. Bad, that iPhone will lose their luxury status. Now that is very dangerous, especially for people who are buying iPhone just for luxury, because it's no longer Ferrari is no longer Ferrari if everybody has Ferrari. So making an iPhone that is $750, and then making an iPhone that is $1,000, then making an iPhone that is $1,300 or $1,200, it's no longer gives that elite status. Like, because a lot of people will buy a $700 phone, and okay, everything is awesome with that, but if you buy a $1,300 phone, you can't really say that, I have iPhone anymore, because there are so many. Earlier the iPhone was like, you have iPhone. Now then it was like, okay, iPhone medium size and iPhone large size. Now there are like three things. At this point, Apple is doing what Samsung used to do, like, creating a lot of product lineup, and then this there is a new approach to Apple's product is that now they are actually taking Indian and Chinese market much more seriously. So they have introduced dual SIM feature. Now be mindful, even though they want to introduce dual SIM feature, it's not active on the purchase. Like let's say any Indian right now buys a iPhone and they're like, okay, I'm gonna have a dual SIM function. No, simply because you actually have only one slot, SIM slot, and the thing is that it has internal SIM, basically eSIM, which is a new technology that Samsung and Apple in conjunction are working together to make to come reality. So they will give you a QR code, basically your operator, as in Reliance, Jio, or Reliance Jio, Airtel, or Comcast, or basically whoever is giving you a mobile connection, AT&T and things of that nature. They will simply give you a QR code, you will scan it, and you will activate your SIM. The SIM is inbuilt into that. That feature is not active right now. They are still working on the software. So they released a product, and at this point, you can't actually use dual SIM function. Now, why dual SIM is a big deal? It's a very big deal. Like many of people who work in India, they have multiple numbers, and they always keep that multiple number with them. So like, for instance, my brother is a doctor, so he has one mobile number that is dedicated for his work in his factory, where he's the, you know, general doctor, and then another number is dedicated for family purpose. So he doesn't want to carry two phones, he wants to carry one phone. Apple now allows to do that, but still, the phone is out, but the software is not ready. So they're trying to appease the basically China and India market, because be mindful, USA already reached saturation, and India and China combined basically has upwards of 3 billion people. To give you a context, USA's population is 300 million. So there is a kind of a few zeros gap here. So everybody wants to come into China and India for this reason, because market is very young. So focused feature for us, and now they want to make their phone much more accessible. So before before Steve Jobs died, Apple product had a kind of niche feel to it, but they were not very accessible. Like if you had iOS device, if you had Mac, everything was awesome. But now they are trying to make it more awesome against Android. Now Android from day one was much more accessible. So now they are introducing wireless charging and other things, trying to make it more accessible, like their attempt at making Google Pay, basically Google Pay, I'm saying Apple Pay, where you can use your Apple as a wallet. So the Apple is responding to this crisis, because a company as big as Apple have to grow to survive. They cannot be like, okay, let's say, you know, I'm making this much profit. No, they have to make profit and keep doubling it up. Otherwise, they will collapse under their own weight. This happens with large companies. They always have to keep growing. So what does this whole thing mean for you and I and our future? One very simple, USB-C for everything. Now, USB-C is thoroughly built with a lot of foresight. The cable itself, everybody thought like, why do we need a power cable when, you know, your mobile, like this mobile also had speed charging. So the cable that used to charge this is normal micro USB-P, but it could provide upwards of 20 to 30 watts of power. So somebody sat down and is like, okay, let's increase the voltage. So USB-C has a standard, USB power standard, basically where you can pump the voltage upwards of 20 volts and upwards of 5 amps. So 20 volts and 5 amps equals 100 watt. So now you can use your USB system for charging your laptop, which many Mac, many Dell, many HP, basically thin and light are nowadays are using this. So and now you will in the future will have a basically laptop charger that can charge your mobile phone and also your laptop. So and yes, there is communication built into that. So if you plug your laptop charger into your mobile, it's gonna do a handshake. On there are layers on it, so they will do handshake number one, so 5 watts of power, okay, cool. Handshake level two, rejected, because it's not speed charging. So it's like, okay, I'm not gonna give you more power than that. So in laptop, it will keep handshaking until the highest level, and once the handshake is done properly, then it's like, okay, now you take 100 watts of power. So there are a lot of safety features built into the system. So it is acceptable in the future that you're gonna have one cable to rule them all. And it's truly standard, because many people will make multiple accessories with this, and each accessories will be intercompatible with everyone, except Apple's system, because even though Apple is using USB-C, they are putting their own microchip to block using normal. Basically, you can't use these sort of puppy. Even though they can, you can use them in Dell, HP, basically every other company, Apple is like, no, like you have to buy my own thing, which they may disable sooner or later, because Apple is no longer like, you know, growing as they used to grow. And monitor side, I'm really excited about this because right now you can buy a LG monitor and ASUS monitor where you just simply plug the power cable to your monitor, and from your monitor you simply have a USB-C cable. So whenever you connect your thin and light laptop, you just connect the cable. That's it. Your laptop is also charging using that cable itself and also transmitting like 4K 60 frames per second using that cable itself. You don't need two cables anymore. So we have a lot of awesome things to come in the future. And as times go along, even cameras will have USB-C, which current generation of mirrorless cameras like Nikon and Canon mirrorless camera already has USB-C. So even Fuji X-T3 also has USB-C. So all of the world is going towards USB-C sooner or later. So I like the idea that Apple finally in iOS they have figured it out. So I think they will release one more iPhone without USB-C. After that they will release one iPhone which will finally have USB-C. So let's see. And more competition will lead us to buy much more polished product for everyone, because now you will have the option to pay. Because let's say Apple does not horrifically lock their system, the USB-C dock that works with Apple will also work with Dell. It's just that Dell one won't work with Apple. So you can, let's say you are from you like the polish and metal feel of your Apple docks, you can buy Apple docks and just connect it with your Dell or HP. So we will have more competition which will lead us to better products. So this was my presentation on Apple's final launch of a single product that has USB-C, iOS USB-C. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. I would urge you to leave a comment on my video, what you want to see in the next episode of Computer Wednesday. And I would ask you to please subscribe, share it amongst your friends, and press the bell icon if you're free. And as always, thanks for watching.